afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all on behalf of Indo-American Chamber of Commerce. We are organizing this session with our knowledge partner, Grant Thornton, jointly with them. And this is, as you all know, this is a very buzz thing, which is already in discussion in all the corporates. And this is, I think, very important session, and we got a very good participation for this program. To start with this very important session, I request my chairman, Mr. Vijay Sai Mehka, chairman for IACC AP and TS, and the managing director of SS Green Projects Private Limited, to kindly give the welcome remarks. Please, sir.
Yeah. Good afternoon to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all for this important webinar on new labor codes with a view to reform the outmoded labor laws and to facilitate the ease of doing business in India. The government of India had decided to consolidate 29 central labor laws into 4 labor codes, namely the Code on Wages 2019, Industrial Relations Code 2020, the Code on Social Security 2020, and the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code 2020. These codes aim to expand the social security net to the informal sector and migrant workers, promote fixed term employment, equal social security benefits to permanent and fixed term employees, and increase the coverage for payment of minimum wages. Therefore, it is important for stakeholders across industry to gain an understanding of these codes and their impact on HR, payroll, compliances, and company financials. With this backdrop, I would like to thank Mr. Ankur Dalal, Regional Labor Commissioner, Ministry of Labor and Employment, Mr. Akhil Chandra, Associate Partner, Grant Thornton Bharat, and Mrs. Leena Madhok, Director, Grant Thornton Bharat. Now I would like to talk about IACC. The Indo-American Chamber of Commerce is a 50-year-old apex bilateral chamber synergizing India-US economic engagement. The major objective of IACC is to promote Indo-American business, trade, and economic relations between US and India. IACC also promotes bilateral trade, investment, and technology transfer, facilitates business collaborations, joint ventures, marketing tie-ups, and strategic alliances through a set of proactive business-oriented initiatives. IACC AP and TS branch at Hyderabad serves to both of Telugu states, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We regularly organize seminars and interactive meetings for our members and work very closely with the US consulate Hyderabad. We facilitate B2B meetings for inbound delegations from USA with the industry sectors in India and arrange outbound delegations to USA in coordination with our partners in USA and identify potential partners or buyers, etc. Now I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge and appreciate the support of our knowledge partner, Grant Thornton. With these words, I wish the participants a very informative and productive session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your welcome address. Now I'll take this opportunity to briefly introduce our three eminent speakers for the session. Mr. Ankur Dalal, Regional Labor Commissioner, Ministry of Labor and Employment. Mr. Akhil Channa, Associate Partner, Grant Thornton Bharat. And Ms. Leena Mandok, Director, Grant Thornton Bharat. Mr. Ankur Dalal is currently serving as the Regional Labor Commissioner in the Office of the Chief Labor Commissioner in Delhi. He holds a master's degree in law. Mr. Akhil Channa is an associate partner with Grant Thornton in India and leads the global mobility service practice. He has an experience of over 13 years in advising clients across business verticals on tax, social security, and regulatory matters, with specialization in all aspects of domestic and international employee engagements. Akhil is a member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and a lawyer. Ms. Leena Mandok is the director and leads the regulatory practice at Grant Thornton in India. Leena has a work experience of over 20 years across the role in the industry and consulting. Leena is a company secretary and a lawyer. Her specialization is in labor and employment laws, company law, around due diligence, compliance support, advisory, etc. So this with this brief introduction, I request Mr. Dalal to kindly address the participants and give a government perspective on the subject. Over to Mr. Dalal, please.
Thank you. And good afternoon, everybody. So basically, these labor codes present a new opportunity in the labor law reform governance. We could see that labor laws existing as on day were, many of them were pre-independence enactments and were not in sync with the present era. For example, many labor laws prescribed fines of rupees 500, which were not a deterrence to the employers as well as were not giving relief to the workers also. So that required an overhaul and required a rationalization, overall rationalization of every aspect, and to bring these labor laws in tune with the present legal framework, basically. So these labor codes have done not just base minimal changes, but also we can call it labor reforms in the actual sense, because there has been a uniformity of definitions, compounding, new legal mechanisms like compounding of offenses, etc., has been introduced. So we'll be dealing with all this in detail now, and we will answer questions in the QA session. So let us start with analysis.
Thanks, Mr. Dalal, and thanks, Shikha, for the introduction. We are delighted to partner with ICC on this important initiative. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining in. As everyone is aware, there has been a lot of buzz around the new labor codes being introduced by the government over the last 1 year. After GST, this is surely the next big reform, which will impact each and every organization, employees and workers across the board. In today's discussion, we would like to provide an overview of the provisions under the four codes, as Mr. Dalal said, including some of the key definitions, the challenges expected to be faced by the establishments, and the way forward as the government moves towards implementing the codes. As you may be aware, 29 existing labor laws have been consolidated under the four new codes with an intent to amalgamate, simplify, and rationalize the relevant provisions of the subsumed laws. With an objective to bring consistency between the four codes, the government has sought to remove multiple definitions across laws. For example, the definition of wages will be common across the codes. I'm repeating, the definition of wages is common across the codes. This is the biggest move. To facilitate use of technology and ease of compliance is an agenda. Compliance will be rationalized, and all aspects related to registrations, filing, inspection, calling for information, etc., is proposed to be online. Everything is digital. Compounding of offenses and aid in effective enforcement. Then, as we discussed, the intent of the law is to make it more simplified and not to punish, but to give all possible opportunities to the eligible establishments for making all non-compliance good. Now, let's see where we are on these four codes as on now. So it's important to know that while all the four codes have received the president's approval as on September 2020, the code will come into force on the date to be notified by the central government. There's no official date which is notified by the central government as of now. The government has indicated its intent to implement the codes across the countries from 1st April 2021. That's a likely to be date of implementation, but there's no official notification as of now. On Wednesday, that is 28th January, 2 days ago, the government completed tri-party consultations for four new labor codes, moving a step closer to finalizing the rules and their subsequent implementation. Now let's move to the next slide. Coming to the first leg of our discussion for the day, I will request Lina to take us through the provisions under the code on wages. Over to you, Lina.
Thanks, Akhil. So we'll start with the code on wages. As my colleague Akhil has already shared, that the intent of the government is to provide the ease of business. The provisions with respect to limitation, with respect to compounding of offense, the provisions with respect to, like, the new concept which has been introduced is the inspector cum facilitator. So everyone from the industry is looking at the ease of compliances, but let's see how far we can achieve that. So the law which gets subsumed in this code on wages are the Payment of Wages Act, the Minimum Wages Act, the Payment of Bonus Act, and the Equal Remuneration Act. We'll move to the next slide, please. Yeah. So first thing is the wide coverage which this code on wages is providing. We all know that the Payment of Wages Act has a threshold level, and again, the Minimum Wages Act is applicable on the scheduled industry which are specified under the Act. But now, under the Code on Wages, there is no such threshold level which is provided. So it gets applicable to all kind of establishment. And the establishment has been defined as a place where any industry, trade, business, manufacture, or occupation is carried on. It also includes the government establishment. So it has a very wide coverage. When we look at the definition of employee, that again is very wide. It includes person employed on wages by any establishment to do any skilled, semi-skilled or unskilled, manual, technical, clerical, managerial, administrative, supervisory. So it has a very, very wide coverage, and that's why it has a universal application. That's the word we are using nowadays, like it is applicable universally. It covers everyone. And also the definition of employer includes the contractor and their legal representative of the deceased employer. Under the code, as Akhil already shared, that we have common definition which are running across the codes. So we have the definition of wages, which is very common to the Code of Social Security, the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Condition Code, and the IR Code, which is the Industrial Relation Code. Then the definition of employee, employer, the appropriate government, establishment. So these are some of the common definition which have been introduced. What will this do is this will help the employer in going for a uniform kind of compliances rather than referring to each and every act while making the compliances to check the applicability. The employers will be sure that, okay, this is the definition and now I have to accordingly comply with the provisions. The new definition of wages, this says that, you know, your basic cannot be less than 50% of your total remuneration. So this is a new definition which has increased the employer's liability, and it will be covered in very much detail in the coming slides by my colleague Akhil. So I'll skip this one currently. We'll talk about the various provisions of the Payment of Wages Act, which have been subsumed in this code. When we talk about the methods of payments, so we have the new method of payments like the online payment, the check mode payment, etc., which have been allowed under this code. And also in respect of deductions, the total deduction, it says, also the deductions can be only in respect of the matters which have been specified under the code. So the total deductions cannot be more than 50% of an employee's total monthly wages. And deduction, the ground for deductions which are provided are something like fines, absence from duty, accommodation given by the employer, or recovery of advances, etc. Also, in respect of fines, it has been specified that you, before you impose the fine, you have to intimate and take the approval from the authority. So this is a new thing which has been provided. And in respect of, again, the payment of wages, the wage slip is to be provided to the employee. That is a mandatory requirement now. In respect of the timeline for the full and final settlement, there is a new provision that you have to make it within a period of 2 days of the removal, resignation, or retrenchment. And then when we talk about the Minimum Wages Act, what has been introduced is like the floor wages. So this is something which would be specified by the central government, and the state governments won't be able to prescribe a threshold level which will be below this floor level. So this is new concept. Till now, the central government was coming out with a national floor level minimum wage, which was a non-binding wage. So the state government used to go ahead and provide for the wage level, which used to be either below this or above this. But now that kind of provision won't be there. What the state government or the appropriate government can do is just prescribe something above it. So it will kind of give a clarity to the employer to plan for the resources and accordingly go ahead. In terms of the equal gender equality, this is something, as I shared with you, that is also the act which is getting subsumed under this code. So it has provided for equal treatment of gender. So the third gender is also recognized now. It says that there won't be any discrimination on the basis of gender in matters related to wages, recruitment, and work conditions. And the next act which is getting subsumed under this code is the Payment of Bonus Act. Now, for the Payment of Bonus Act, what is provided under the code is that the threshold level on which it is to be calculated, that would be specified by the appropriate government. So those things are what is still awaited by us, because the state governments have not come out with their various rules and the provisions. So this is something to be looked at, how the various state governments will take ahead. So we'll look at the various points which we'll like to discuss and have a clarity. For that, I'll request Mr. Dalal to share his inputs. So sir, in respect of the national floor wages, where the employer has presence in more than one state, when we talk about the floor wages, it has been provided that, you know, it will be decided on the basis of geographical area and skill level, and also the skill level and the industry in which the person is employed. So in such a scenario, if the state governments are going to come out with various threshold levels, it will again become a challenge for industry to, you know, keep a track of each and every kind of wage levels. So what is your input regarding that?
Basically, this floor wage is dealt by Section 9 of Code on Wages. And now the central government is empowered by virtue of Code on Wages to prescribe a national floor wage. And as you mentioned, that presently also a non-binding floor wage is being prescribed by the central government. But I would like to highlight that the existing non-binding floor wage is based on the price index of rural labor, and therefore it is very less. And thus many state governments have not revised their basic wages. That should ordinarily be revised after every 5 years. So many states have not revised their basic wages even after 10 years. So in order to avoid such instances where state governments have not been revising their basic wages after even 5 years, so this concept of floor wage will be very helpful for the workers as well as the industry, because now there will be clarity that to do business in a state, this will be the minimum floor cost for labor. And state governments also have to prescribe wages above this wage. So in my view, this is a very good concept and will provide a basic floor for the whole nation.
Yes, sir, that is true. But again, like the industry will have to keep track on the basis of various geographical area, the skill set, and also the location. So I think that is going to continue over here also, right?
Ma'am, presently also state governments are appropriate government under the Minimum Wages Act. So they are coming up with new kinds of wages. Even today, all state governments have different kinds of wages for different skill sets. So Code on Wages has prescribed now that the number of wages to be prescribed by the appropriate government shall be kept to the minimum. This is also prescribed in the Code on Wages. So the multiplicity of wages to be prescribed by appropriate government will also reduce now to only four, that is unskilled, skilled, semi-skilled and highly skilled. So there will be no further bifurcation of categorization of workers now, firstly. And secondly, a base floor shall be set by the central government. So in my view, this will bring more clarity for the pan-India organization.
Okay, sir. So next is the overtime. Now, as we see from the definition of employee, it covers the managerial and the administrative people also. So in that context, I guess the industry needs some clarity about how to keep a track and, you know, whether it is applicable to a managerial personnel or not. So there are challenges around that. Will you like to share some views on that?
Yeah, this is a very good question, and a lot of confusion is there on this aspect. So if we do a literal interpretation of Section 14 of Code on Wages, it says, I quote from Section 14, that where an employee whose minimum rate of wages has been fixed under this code works on any day in excess of the number of hours constituting normal working day, the employer shall pay him the overtime. So basically, it says that only those employees for whom minimum wages have been fixed by the appropriate government, they will be eligible for overtime. So legally, now Code on Wages says that everybody will be entitled to overtime. You are correct. But then there is a rider in Section 14, which says that only those employees whose minimum rates of wages has been fixed, they will be eligible for overtime. So we will have to see in the rules that for which all category of employees minimum rate of wages are being fixed by the appropriate government. So for example, doctors or certain categories which will be outside the ambit of Code on Wages and whose minimum rates of wages are not being fixed, they will not be entitled to overtime as per the literal interpretation of Section 14.
Okay, sir, thanks. That's a good clarification. So we'll move on to the next question. So what is the new enforcement mechanism which is going to be there in the Code on Wages? If you could just elaborate on that so that everyone has a clarity in respect of that.
So there is a overhaul of the enforcement mechanism in Code on Wages from the existing mechanism. Existing mechanism was fragmented, different enforcement agencies, and in fact, even courts were involved. I will give you an example. For example, in Payment of Wages Act, for any unauthorized deduction or non-payment of wages, the appropriate authority was the enforcement agency was the labor commissioner or his officer, and the appeal lied to the sessions court. Similarly, in the Minimum Wages Act, the appropriate authority was the officer of the labor commissioner. In the central government, it was regional labor commissioner, and the appeal, there was no provision for appeal against the order of the authority under Minimum Wages Act, and employers or the worker had to approach the High Court under Article 226. Now what has been done is to bring uniformity in authorities under the Minimum Wages Act, Payment of Wages Act, Equal Remuneration Act, and all the laws subsumed in under Code on Wages. There is one common authority to adjudicate the claims. And also there is a provision for administrative appeal. So the appellate forum will now be administrative. Unlike the earlier scenario where appeal lied before Sessions Court or a writ jurisdiction before the High Court, now there's a provision for administrative appeal before the appellate authority to be appointed by the appropriate governments. Further, there is a provision of compounding of offenses and also provision for imposition of penalty by the administrative appointed authorities. So imposition of penalty now has also been delegated in respect of certain minor offenses to the administrative bodies. So now prosecutions may not be filed before the civil court, and employers and workers need not approach or run behind their long proceedings before the civil court, and penalties can now be imposed for minor offenses by the administrative body. So this is a total overhaul of the enforcement mechanism.
So that's good relief for the industry, I guess. So moving next to the next question, we have few questions and the doubts which everyone has regarding the definition of wages. So I think these questions will be dealt in great detail by my colleague Akhil in the coming session. So we'll come to the payment of bonus. In case of payment of bonus, again, we have the same question as we have in respect of the national floor wages, where the appropriate government is now going to provide the threshold levels on which the bonus is going to be paid. So again, there is some kind of challenge which industry may face, and they may have to keep a track of the various threshold level by different states. So this is one challenge which they are facing. So will you like to share your views on that?
In this regard, if we read section 26 of Code on Wages, it is quite interesting that the threshold or the eligibility criteria for the employees eligible to get bonus is to be determined by the appropriate government, that is the state governments. So there will be scenario that in Kerala, some highly paid workers, the threshold for eligibility threshold may be higher than in Bihar. So that will depend from state to state as to which workers will be eligible to receive bonus in that state.
Yes, sir. I agree with you. So this is something to be, that the industry will be required to keep a track. So we'll move to the next code, which is the Social Security Code. I'll request my colleague Akhil to take over.
Thanks, Lina, for taking us through the provision under the Code on Wages, and Mr. Dalal for the valuable inputs on some of the questions that's on everyone's mind. Moving on, let us now look into the next important code, that is the Code on Social Security, which is a significant step in moving towards bringing in a universal coverage for all working people in the country. The Code on Social Security subsumes 9 regulations related to key legislation such as ESI, Provident Fund, maternity benefits, and gratuity. The most significant reform envisaged by the Code on Social Security is introducing universal coverage for all wage or salary earners. So under this new code, workers from unorganized sectors and even self-employed individuals have been brought under the ambit of the Social Security. Let us look at the key impact areas for the organizations. Yeah. First and the foremost is coverage and registrations. In terms of threshold limit for coverage, it still remains the same. That is 20 workers for the Provident Fund and 10 workers for the ESI. Provisions related to gratuity, maternity benefits would be applicable to every factory, mine, plantation, port, railway company, and every shop and establishment with 10 or more employees. In terms of voluntary opt-in and opt-out, as everyone knows, under the existing PF law, there's no other option available to put opt-out even if the employee strength falls below the threshold of 20 employees. However, under the new code, an establishment can make an application to the relevant authority for opting out of such coverage based on agreement between the employer and the majority of the employees. The relevant authority may make the provisions of the relevant chapter inapplicable to such establishments. I think it's a welcome step if you know that option is something which people were looking for. Now, the second big change is definition of wages. I think Lina already talked about it. I'll quickly cover this, illustration or in detail in the next slides. However, just to give a clarity, uniformity in determining wages for the purpose of Social Security benefit is one of the key impact areas for the organization. Given the vagueness in the current regulations, especially in respect to Provident Fund, where clarity was received after the Supreme Court ruling in February 2019, this is definitely a welcome step. As I said, we'll cover in detail in the coming slides. The third other key change is introduction of new category of beneficiaries. Unorganized worker, gig worker, and platform worker are new category of employees which have been introduced. Specific definitions for unorganized worker, organized sector have been brought in to expand the coverage of social security benefits. Gig worker and platform worker are two new categories of workers brought under the code and have been much talked about. Gig worker has been defined as a person who performs work or participates in a work arrangement and earns from such activity outside of traditional employer and employee relationship. So gig workers would typically cover freelancers, workers who are employed on a contractual basis or for project-based work and short-term work. Top-of-the-mind examples would be individuals providing food or other delivery services to Zomato, Swiggy, or to e-commerce platforms such as Amazon of the world and Flipkart of the world. This could also include other riders engaged by such platforms providing last-mile delivery services. Now let's discuss about the platform worker. So to give a perspective, platform worker are persons who use an online platform to access other organizations or individuals to provide specific services in exchange for payment. Popular example that comes on my mind would be Ola and Uber, drivers who work on the app-based platforms. This would also include other freelancers carrying out any vocation or profession using online platforms provided by the aggregators. The draft rules provide the framework for registering for benefits of this category of individuals. As per the draft rules, an individual who is between the age of 16 to 60 years, I'll again repeat 16 to 60 years, and has been engaged as a gig or platform workers for at least 90 days in a 12-month period can register for such benefits. I think this is one of the great move because these are the people who have been left out of this Social Security, ESI and other benefits. Now they've been brought in under the ambit of the new code. So some of the key elements I would like to quickly highlight here for these category of workers are, now they will be, as I said, they will become eligible for life disability coverage, accident insurance, health and maternity benefits, old age protection, crutch, etc., all benefits. The schemes to fund them might be through a combination of contribution from the central government, state governments, beneficiary, and the employers. More clarity is required on this. It is important for us to note that in case of gig workers and platform workers, these are specified as arrangements which are outside the traditional employee-employer relationships. It is therefore important for establishments who will qualify as aggregators to assess the implications and compliance requirements under the code as you know, making them as a part of their employees and, you know, covering them on all the benefits. We are talking about huge implications on these aggregators kind of business. Interestingly, the terms gig worker, platform worker only appears in the code on Social Security, but not in other labor codes. We have to be very mindful about that. Therefore, such workers are expected to benefit from the programs released by the government, but not with respect to other labor rights. Apart from this, there's another concept of fixed-term employment, which has been brought in the code, where the contract of employment is for a predefined period as against the open-ended employment contract, as we see in many organizations currently. So we've talked about coverage and registration. We talked about definition of wages. We talked about introduction of new category of beneficiaries. Now let's go to, you know, the most important part of any organization which directly impacts the P&L is the gratuity payment. Given that definition of wages has been widened and the category of workers eligible for gratuity has been increased, there would be an increased cost burden on the employers. Therefore, employers would need to review the provision for gratuity that has been created, especially in case they have a fixed term employees, as they are entitled to receive gratuity without completion of 5 years of continuous service. I'm repeating. So there's a new category of workers which have been introduced, fixed term workers, and now the gratuity is payable to them even if they have not completed 5 years of service on a proportionate basis. So this is a point to be noted by everyone. Second is the concept of principal employer is expanded by including gratuity payable to the contract laborers as well in case of default by the contractor. So in the existing law, this concept was extended only to the extent of PF and ESI when you are hiring contract labor. But now the gratuity is also a liability of the principal employer if the contractor through which contract labor is hired are not getting the provident fund, ESI, or gratuity payment. Other one is Aadhaar prerequisite. I think mandatory for registration, availing benefits, and withdrawal of PF. It's important, KYC now, which everyone has to comply with. The code requires all individuals to obtain Aadhaar if they qualify as resident under the Aadhaar Act 2016. Last but not the least, transition provisions. The code provides that EPF, EPS, and EDLAI schemes would be applicable in 1 year after the code is implemented. The threshold limit would be specified under the EPF scheme or notified by the central government. So we've covered the key impact areas. Right now, we've taken these six. There are many needs to be looked into. Now we can move to the next slide, and you know, or maybe you know, few areas where we've not highlighted here. I want to just you know quickly cover that as well. Before we come to the definition of wages, I think which is the much talked about in the industry. So there are other key areas like introduction, a limitation period of 5 years for initiation of queries by the authorities for assessment and determination of money due from employers. Again, I think big relief. Also such inquiries has to be concluded within a period of 2 years. So the government, as we said in the beginning, the purpose of coming out with for this four codes is to rationalize, simplify and remove ambiguity. So with that intention, they've come up with a period of limitation for 5 years. So in the existing currently, there's no limitation period in prescribed in EPF and ESI. Introduction of limitation period will provide certainty to establishment in respect of past year matters and also ease the burden of maintaining supporting documents and books for a longer period. As I said, it's a big relief and a welcome step. Also, the code 2020 defines interstate migrant worker, which clarifies that a worker who belongs to one state and has obtained employment in another state would also be an interstate worker and protected as an unorganized worker. Having said that, it has also been provided that a person would be considered as interstate migrant worker if they're drawing wages up to 18,000 per month or such higher amount as notified by the government from time to time. Again, the concept of career centers has been reinforced in the code. It will be mandatory for establishments to report the vacancy to career center before filling up the vacancy. However, there's no obligation on the employer to recruit through the career center. So with this, I've concluded on the key impact areas and other key changes. Now we'll come to the definition of wages. The definition of wages has been aligned with the definition under the wage code, and we can see this in three parts. First, a broad inclusive definition, which covers all remuneration, whether in cash or kind. Then 11 exclusions have been specified for calculating wages on which social security benefits would be calculated. Out of those exclusions, there's a cap, 50% cap on the total amount of exclusion. What this would mean is that various benefits will be calculated on at least 50% of the total remuneration. Moving to the illustration, I think we try to you know, simplify and discuss this in two scenarios. In scenario one, when we see the total remuneration of an employee is 25,000, out of that, we've taken the specified exclusions which has been prescribed. It's coming 11,000. So the definition of the wages is 40,000 on which the PF or other retirement benefits needs to be computed. That's fine because as we said, the specified exclusion is capped to 50%. Here it's less than 50%. That's okay. 14,000 is perfectly fine. In scenario two, where you know the specified exclusions is 13,000, which is more than 50% of the total remuneration. There's a capping of 50%, and then definition and the wages for the purpose of PF contribution and other is 12,500. Moving to the next slide, you know, we have taken a simple illustration to explain the impact on gratuity, how it will be determined and look like in the new Social Security code. Let's take the case of an individual whose cost to the company is 20 lakhs, where the basic is 5 lakh, and there are other typical components. In this case, the wages for the purpose of computing gratuity under the Payment of Gratuity Act, which is existing, is 41,667 per month. This increases more than two times to 98,508 per month under the Code on Social Security. So, you know, due to this, We have you know, assumed that 10 years of service, there's almost a double impact on the payment of gratuity under the Social Security code. As I said in my key impact areas as well, we have to be very cautious and we have to see this as this will impact the P&L of each and every organization. Moving ahead, illustration impact on maternity benefit. The definition of wages also has an impact on the maternity benefit. However, considering the same compensation details, as we discussed under gratuity illustration, the wages on which maternity benefit would be calculated under the code is reduced from 1,57,500 to 98,508. As we can see, the payouts to employees and the cost to the employer will undergo a change once the new regime is made effective. Yes, moving ahead on, you know, illustration impact on ESI benefits. Here we have taken a case where the annual wage is 2,50,000 because as we said, the coverage is same, 21,000. So we have taken an example where the people are getting covered under the ESI benefit. So depending on the components in the salary in such case, in view of the specified exclusion in the definition of wages, it is likely that the amount considered for computing ESI would be reduced in some cases. So these are all illustrations, and you know, this is on the basis of the interpretation of law as of now. These might undergo some changes, but we just thought that to give a perspective and to give a better understanding, we would cover this. Now, I think majorly we have covered the key changes and some illustrations, the impact and everything. Now I'll come to Mr. Dalal. There are a lot of questions in our mind related to practical aspects of transition and implementation, how everything gonna look like. A few questions we have received before webinar, we've tried to cover that, and you know, the queries which we have been getting while interacting with audience at large. So starting with the new age workers covers under the code, I would request Mr. Dalal to share his thoughts on the mechanism and visage in the code to provide social security to the gig and platform workers.
Akhil, as you just mentioned that these codes, social security code especially, has incorporated new category of workers, that is gig workers and platform workers. Gig worker is defined as workers who are outside the traditional employer-employee relationship. Now, this is very important because with the changing nature of work, it is very difficult to prove traditional employer-employee relationship, and our labor laws up till now are heavily premised upon proof of this employer-employee relationship. Only once this proof is made, labor laws become applicable. So if a worker fails to prove this relationship, then labor laws are of no use to him. And in respect of these gig workers, there is a typical work engagement scenario, because they are engaged by an online platform called, maybe like a Uber is hiring workers, is engaging drivers, and we are taking services of those drivers. So the online platform, that is Uber, says that we are not employing them. We are simply service provider in between and helping consumers and drivers to interact together. So these such online platforms have been termed as aggregator. Aggregator is basically online marketplace. So gig workers are basically anybody who's working outside traditional employer-employee relationship, and this could be online or offline. We are giving example of online workers now, these Ola or Uber drivers. These codes now envisage that these aggregators will pay some cess, like the social security regime for building and other construction workers presently. So the employer, that is the aggregator, will pay some cess. That cess will be between 1-2% of the annual turnover, and there is a ceiling of 5% of the wages paid to the persons engaged by that aggregator. So that cess will be paid. That cess will be utilized, number one. Number two, central government or state government, as you mentioned, can pay some funds in that account. And also there is a creation of an unorganized worker social security fund. This fund will be recouped through the money proceeds received from the compounding of offenses. In all laws, the money received out of compounding of offenses is deposited with the Consolidated Fund of India. But now in these labor laws, except for code on wages, in all other three codes, provision has been made that the proceeds from compounding of offenses will be deposited in the unorganized worker social security fund. So all this money will be utilized for providing social security to gig workers. Now, what will be the mechanism to provide social security? Number one, as you said, schemes can be made by the central government and not the state government. Number two is to utilize the infrastructure of ESIC and EPFO. So express provision has been made enabling these social security organizations, that is EPFO and ESIC, to make schemes for them for gig workers. Further, the ESIC hospitals have also been opened to general public on payment of certain user charges, and these user charges will be nominal. So we can say that the existing infrastructure will be utilized for gig workers also.
I think Mr. Dalal, looks like there's a lot of clarity and determination to expand this such benefits to the gig workers and platform workers. I think, as I said, it's a welcome move, and thanks for clarifying that. Moving to the next question, though there are many establishments, this is in relation to gratuity. Though there are many questions related to gratuity that people might have, but one important question which we have is whether all establishments now be mandatorily required to transfer the fund to a third party for gratuity provisions. Many small and medium organizations currently do not have this practice. So what's your thought on this?
Basically, I think you are asking about compulsory insurance provision.
Yeah.
So if you go through the existing Payment of Gratuity Act 1972, very same provision exists there, and the same provision has been carried forward in the Code on Social Security. And the only change is in respect of, earlier it was mentioned that compulsory insurance is to be with LIC. Now it has been mentioned that it can be with any insurer registered with IRDA. So this is the only change. So existing position will continue unless some specific rules are framed in respect of this section.
So Mr. Dalal, you know, as you know, we've received this question, the people, MSME, currently they do not follow this practice. You said this is there in the existing law. Yes. So that's a non-compliance on their part already.
I think presently, though no rules, I will have to confirm this, but as far as I know, that no rules exist on this aspect in the present Payment of Gratuity Act.
Okay. But in the new code, this is something which is required to be done, irrespective whether you are MSME or you are a big MNC, or but if you are maintaining a gratuity, yeah.
The draft rules published on Code on Social Security also did not consist any specific rule in this regard.
Okay.
It is my personal view that present position will continue.
Okay, understood. So, you know, another question in again with respect to gratuity payable to fixed term employees. So in case a fixed term contract is more than 1 year, say 2 or 3 years, and if the employee resigns before completing the contract, would gratuity still be payable? I think I can take this question. As we discuss about the new concept of fixed term employees, the question is again that even if the fixed term contract is more than 1 year, and say 2 or 3 years, and then the person resigns before completing the contract, what's the position? I think the draft rule provides that in case an employee on fixed term employment, the eligibility for gratuity would be where he renders services under the contract for a period of 1 year. Payment of gratuity would be on same basis that at the rate of 15 days wages for every completed year of service or part exceeding 6 months. So I think it's the employer is liable to pay the gratuity there. Now moving to the fourth question, will definition of wages be grandfathered as per the earlier definition for liability till the date of implementing the code for the purpose of gratuity, sir?
Yes.
Okay, I think that's very clear. Sir, again, the Code on Social Security provides that a EPF, EPS, EDLI schemes shall remain in force for a period of 1 year from the date of commencement of the code. Is that right? So my question on that, whether the definition of wages would be considered as per the existing law or as per the new code on the social security during the transition period?
During the transition period, the existing definitions will continue. And when express provisions are made for commencement, presently these codes have been notified. And after notification, central government will provide a date for commencement. Only on providing that date of commencement, these laws will come in force. So up till that time, present definitions will continue.
Fine, I think that's clear. Moving ahead, many organizations have set up a private PF Trust, as you know, sir. So what would be the transition provisions for the private PF Trust? I think, correct me if I'm wrong, the code provides that exemption provided under any of the enactments shall continue to be enforced till its validity express or it ceases to be in operation under the code. So exemption for private PF Trust would continue, right?
Right.
Okay, thank you. The next question many people have is with respect to the impact on Provident Fund contribution, where the employee's existing salary is above the threshold of either 15,000 per month. So since the salary is already above the threshold, will there be any impact on the contribution due to change in the definition of wages? What's your view on that, sir?
It is expressly provided that an employer shall be liable to pay EPF contributions up to a limit, that is 15,000. So if for the wages above 15,000, an employer is not legally bound to pay EPF contribution.
Okay. And sir, I remember Lena when she was discussing on code on wages, on the performance bonus, because in exclusions, that 11 exclusions which are specified, the government has clearly mentioned the statutory bonus. And in many organizations, there are performance bonus, joining bonus, different kind of bonuses which are given by the employers. So will that be excluded for the purpose of coming to the definition of wages, or will that, there's a lot of ambiguity on that. So if you throw some light on that, sir, would be nice.
To answer your question, there has to be a literal interpretation of definition of wages in all the codes, which is same, and different terms being used, like you just used performance bonus or any other kind of allowance, which is not expressly mentioned, which is not expressly excluded, shall constitute part of wages.
Okay. So you mean to say that if the government, because right now under existing law, it's specifically excluded from the salary for the purpose of PF. However, under the new code definition of wages, statutory bonus, that's it. So you mean to say that if it's not specifically excluded, then it might be a situation that will become a part of remuneration and will not come under the exclusion definition.
Yeah,
right?
As per literal interpretation of this definition and the way you explained, also in light of the recent Supreme Court judgment, Vivekananda case decided in 2019, which clearly stated that this is a inclusionary definition. It includes everything except for those what is excluded from this definition. So express exclusions are provided, only those things are excluded and others will be included in the definition of wages.
Okay, I think that's interesting. Might be we have more clarity by the government while we come closer to the date of implementation, or some FAQs will be released to give that clarification.
This will be clear once rules are also framed, if some clarifications are there. Otherwise, this is a matter of interpretation. Now, in light of Vivekananda case, someone may argue that this is not a regular allowance, not a uniform allowance. So this has to be interpreted. And from literal interpretation, only things which are excluded from wages, and all other aspects will be part of wages, all other remuneration.
Okay. And sir, I'm just taking one step more. We'll take not much of your time and move to the other codes. So, there's another way of incentivize employees these days by way of giving ESOPs, employee stock option, which is not a part of total CTC, it's over and above most of the time, or sometimes a part of CTC as well with cost to the company, the total remuneration. So in your view, will that, because that's also not specifically excluded, so that will also be a part of total remuneration to arrive at the definite wages on which PF and other retirement benefits needs to be contributed?
See, if you read the definition of wages, the first proviso says that, provided that for calculating wages under this clause, if payments made by the employer to the employee under clause A to I exceeds 1/2 or such other percent as may be notified by the central government of all the remuneration calculated under this clause, the amount which exceeds such 1/2 or the percent so notified shall be deemed to be remuneration and shall accordingly added in the wages under this clause. So basically, from A to I requires to be analyzed, and whatever falls within A to I, if it exceeds 1/2, then it will come into will form part of wages. So this allowance which you are talking about, ESOP, requires to be analyzed in light of clauses A to I of this definition of wages, and accordingly our interpretation will have to be made. So it will be difficult to give you a prima facie and ready-made reply as of now without proper examination.
Understood. I think in interest of time, though, there are many questions, many gray areas which need to be discussed and seek clarity from you. we'll move to the another code, and I request Lina to take it forward from here. Over to you, Lina.
Thanks, Akhil. So we'll move on to the Occupational Safety, Health and Working Condition Code. This code has 13 acts which are getting subsumed. Out of that, the main code, main acts which are getting subsumed are the Factories Act, the Contract Labor Regulation and Registration Act, and the Interstate Migrant Workmen Act. Apart from that, there are industry-specific acts like the Sales Promotion Employees, Cine Workers, Docks, Plantation, Mine. So we'll go through the provisions once by one. The first provision is with respect to the registration. It is applicable to all establishment, and I shared with you the establishment will cover all kind of shop and establishments. So it becomes applicable to IT, ITES industry also. And it is also applicable on factory where 10 or more workers are employed. So in respect of registration, the applicability threshold for factory is 10 or more workers. Whereas in respect of the applicability of other provisions of this code, the threshold is 20 and 40. So that has been increased by what has been provided currently. And in respect of registration, you have to apply once you become eligible for registration. And in case it is not, the registration doesn't come across, then you are deemed to be registered within the specified time period. And in case the registration is required and you don't go for registration, then you are not eligible to employ any employee in the establishment. Also, it provides that in case you are registered under any central law or any such law as the appropriate government may specify, then this registration won't be required. Once you go for closure, then again the intimation is required to be provided to the specified authorities. Now this provision, this code has the provisions of the Factories Act. So we come across the provision with respect to the benefits which are to be provided to the employees. Then this code has the provision with respect to contractor and the interstate migrant workers. So we'll go through the provisions one by one. In respect of the concept, there is this concept of core and non-core activity. Core activity is the activity for which your establishment has been formed and anything incidental and ancillary to that. So what this code does is that in respect of the core activities, it goes ahead and says that you cannot have the contract worker under the core activity. So it bars the employment of contract worker on the non-core activity. However, it says it excludes some activities such as the sanitation, security, canteen, loading, unloading, courier, housekeeping, gardening, etc. Also, there are some exceptions. It says that in case of normal functioning, if the functioning is such that the normal functioning is done to the contractor or the activity is such that it does not require the full-time worker, then you can go ahead and have the contract labor employed in those activities. So this is one change which has come in, that you cannot have the contract worker in the core activity. In respect of the duties of employer, it has defined what is the duty of employer and what are the welfare activities that the employer is required to provide. So the welfare activity required to be provided includes the crutch facility at suitable location and distance, either separately or along with the common facilities. Also, in respect of the crutch facilities, the provisions are already there in the Maternity Benefit Act. So there are national guidelines also. So we'll have to, this has to be read according to that. The code provides for special provision with respect to women employees. In respect of women employees, it says that they can work in the night shift which is like before 6 a.m. and after 7 p.m., subject to conditions like safety, holiday, and working conditions. And also an express consent needs to be obtained from them. So in this regard, while drafting the various employment contract and the HR policies, this provision has to be kept in mind, and we can take the consent beforehand. So in respect of the leave rules and leave encashment, the provisions are there. And it says that, you know, normal working day will be a period of 8 hours and the weekly 6 days. Overtime is specified at the rate of twice the prescribed rates, and the annual leave is the entitlement is 1 day for every 20 days. And if you have worked for 180 days and if you have joined after that, then it is the 1/4 of the total period you have worked. And the accumulation and carry forward is allowed for a period of 30 days. Now the new provision is there that at the end of the calendar year, the worker can go ahead and ask for the encashment of leave. So this is something which the employer will have to keep in mind for the cash flow purposes. As I say, that the duties of employees and employers have been specified. So one of the duty of the employer is also to make a provision for annual health check. Apart from that, he has to keep the workplace free from hazard and, you know, comply with the safety standards and also provide a safe working condition to the employees. And the duty of employees are such as, like, you know, they have to comply with the provided health and safety standards, and they have to cooperate with the employer in meeting statutory obligation and inform about unsafe and unhealthy condition. So these are some of the duties which have been specified for the employee and employer, which have to be kept in mind while drafting your HR policies. When we talk about the contractor, the provision of the contract Labor Regulation Act has been incorporated under this act. So it says that every establishment which has 50 or more worker, or every manpower supplier or contractor, they'll have to go for registration if they are supplying 50 or more contract labor. So the contractor is required to obtain a license. Single license valid all over India, and the validity would be for a period of 5 years. And this is delinking from the present system of obtaining license for each and every work order. So this is something which has been brought about. And also I'd like to mention over here that in case the contractor is not fulfilling the duties, like it is not paying the bonus, etc., or gratuity, then the liability comes on the principal employer. Also, under this code, in respect of welfare activities like the bathing space or, you know, rest area, canteen facilities, so the liability is on the principal employer. So while drafting your contract with the various contractor, you have to keep in mind that, you know, you are going to have this additional burden on you. So make the provisions accordingly. Also, the code has the provision with respect to the interstate migrant worker. So in respect of interstate migrant worker, if you have 10 or more interstate migrant worker which are employed either directly or through a contractor, then in that case, there are certain duties which have been prescribed under the code. The duty includes, like, you have to provide for a suitable conditions of work. In case of any fatal accident, etc., you have to inform the government, like the government where your industry is established, and also the his home state, and also inform the kin. And you also need to perform for, need to make provision for all the benefits such as the PF, ESI, medical. So these are some of the things which have been brought about by this code. We'll talk about the points which have some implication under this code. So Mr. Dalal, I'd like to invite you to share your views on this. As we already know that this is applicable on IT and ITS industry also. So in respect of the IT and ITS industry, so this is something extra which they'll have to comply with the Shop and Establishment Act. That's the general thinking. So, and also there might be conflict with the provisions of the Shop and Establishment Act. So what are your views? Like, how do we go about the compliances, or is it something extra which these industry will be required to do, or this is something which they may not be required to do, like anything extra?
Before I come on to question, I will just highlight one or two important aspects in OSH code. Basically, one of the most important aspect of OSH code is creation of a national database of all the establishments in the country employing 10 or more than 10 workers. So basically, the provision of registration in section 3, chapter 2 of OSH code will enable our country to have a robust database of all the establishments in the country employing more than 10 workers. Because as Lina just told, that provision of registration is now mandatory for all establishments with more than 10 workers. So this registration will lead to creation of a national database of all the establishments in the country, and which will pave the way of e-governance and e-inspection. So this will be a major reform in the governance of labor laws because of this section of mandatory registration. And also this mandatory registration will not cause any hardship to the employers because of section 3 sub clause 8, which clearly says that existing establishments already registered under any central labor law, number one, and number two, registered under any notified law of the state government. So central government will notify certain laws of the state government, for example, Shop and Establishment Act. So if this act is notified, then all establishments which are already registered in these central laws or notified laws, they will not be required to re-register, but will have to intimate about their registration so that the database is robust and live. So this is one of the important aspects in OSH code. Second important aspect which I want to highlight regarding OSH code is the mandatory duty on the employer to provide appointment letter to a worker. Up till now, there was no statutory duty casted upon the employer to give appointment letters. So now a right has been created for a worker to demand appointment letter so that he can prove employer-employee relationship. And also for a contractor, express duty has been made that a contract labor can seek experience certificate from him about his employment. So these are some important things. And now I will come on to the question regarding the impact of these changes on IT and ITS industry. And the question asked was about any incongruency which may arise with the Shop and Establishment Act. Firstly, OSH code applies on establishments. Establishment includes any trade, occupation, and service sector also, apart from factory, because in the definition of establishment, factory has a different threshold. So factory will be considered differently, not 10, but 20 and 40, I think. When it is running with the aid of power, then 20, and without aid of the power, then it is 40. And for any other trade occupation, so if employing more than 10, then that will be considered as establishment and will be covered under OSH code. So IT and ITS industry will be covered under OSH code. Earlier position was these provisions were contained in the Factories Act, which was applicable only on factory. Now, coverage has been expanded to establishment. So if there is any incongruity or inconsistency between the OSH code and Shop and Establishment Act, then in my personal view, because both of these laws pertain to labor, and labor is subject of concurrent list in the 7th schedule of the Constitution. And as per law, if there is inconsistency between the central and state law in the concurrent list, the central law will prevail. So, and also if the Shop and Establishment Act provides for better provisions than these minimum benchmarks prescribed in the OSH code, then there is no problem. But if some Shop and Establishment Act provides for lesser brand benchmarks, then OSH code benchmarks will prevail over those benchmarks.
Okay, sir. So in that case, we'll have to go by what this code is providing, right?
Yes, right.
Okay. So also there is a lot of issue going on around the core and the non-core activities, like what will constitute my core activity and what is, where can I have my contract labor, and where is the position where I cannot have the contract labor. So if you could just share your views around that.
See, essentially the basic philosophy for defining core and non-core activity was that in core activities, an establishment should have its permanent employees and contract laborers should not be employed in the core activity. So this is the basic philosophy behind this provision. And also, if you can recall, the earlier subsumed law, that is Contract Labor Regulation and Abolition Act. So there were two aims of that Contract Labor Act, which is subsumed in this law. Two aims were regulation and abolition. And for abolition, there was a provision in that act, I think it is section 10, which provides that if an establishment employs contract labor in perennial activity. So there was a prohibition to appoint contract laborers for perennial activity in an establishment. Now that aspect has been more clarified. Core and non-core activity has been defined, which was not defined earlier. Earlier, Andhra Pradesh state law defined this aspect, and in the same way, now the central law is also defining core and non-core activities. In the non-core activities, establishments are allowed to hire contract labor. You have already elaborated about this aspect. And if a dispute arises, whether it is a core activity or a non-core activity, then as per section 57 clause 2, appropriate government will appoint designated authorities. So these authorities will act as a quasi-judicial authorities to adjudicate this issue. So this is the basic aspect, and you have already dealt about the definition of core and non-core.
Yes, sir. So maybe with the various judgments which will come around it, and also with the help of the inspector come facilitator, we'll be able to have some guidance about what would constitute our core activity and what would constitute our non-core activity. So this is something which we'll have to wait for and watch about. So we'll come to the next point, which is about the interstate migrant worker. So in respect of them, what is the change which has been brought about in this code? How is it different from what was there as on date?
This experience of lockdown has brought about big changes in respect of interstate migrant worker. Akhil has already dealt with one change, that is the definition of interstate migrant worker. Now, if we look at the definition brought in the OSH code and the definition which existed in the Interstate Migrant Workmen Act, you will see a sea of change, because in the definition in the Interstate Migrant Workmen Act was a very restrictive definition. And according to that definition, ISMW meant only those workers who were hired through a contractor. So this is a very different definition from its natural meaning of interstate migrant worker. Now, the dictionary meaning or the natural meaning of interstate migrant worker has been brought in the OSH code, by virtue of which all workers hired by employer or through a contractor from one state for employment in another state shall be considered to be interstate migrant worker. This is one big change brought in the OSH code about interstate migrant worker. The other change, the need for which was felt during the lockdown was there was no database of migrant workers. Now, attempt has been made and a clear express provision is there in the OSH code by virtue of which the appropriate governments have to keep live database of migrant workers. Number third change brought, which is a major change, is providing facility of portability of ration card is one thing, portability of ration cards, and secondly is portability of their building and other construction worker fund and benefits from one state to another state. As you know that most of the construction workers are migrant workers, so when they migrate from one state to another state, they lose all the benefits of the building and other construction worker board. So it is envisaged that those benefits will also be portable now. So we'll have to see in rules how this mechanism is done. So these are the main changes brought for the benefit of interstate migrant workers. And secondly, your question as to who will be responsible for compliance obligations. So this is a very interesting question. If you see the definition of contract labor in the OSH code, that is section 2 sub clause M, it defines contract labor as worker who, the definition expressly states in the fourth line that contract labor includes interstate migrant worker. So contract labor, all the provisions pertaining to contract labor chapter will also be applicable for the interstate migrant worker, because now contract labor will include interstate migrant worker also. So as you know that the contract labor chapter will apply only on those establishments employing 50 or more contract workers. So for those establishments, firstly, the primary responsibility will fall on the contractor and the secondary responsibility will fall upon the principal employer. And for other establishments, that is for on whom that contract labor chapter is not applicable, because principal employer concept is there only in that chapter. So for other, for establishments employing less than 50 employees, the employer, that is the contractor, will be liable to provide all the benefits. So this is the literal interpretation of this, these provisions. Now, an interesting aspect is how employer is also defined. So judiciary in future may expand that liability of contractor to also principal employer. If we interpret the term employer in a wide sense, but the literal interpretation and the scheme of the law says that primary responsibility for establishments with less than 50 contract labor will be on the contractor to provide all the benefits, and for more than 50 will be on the contractor, then on the principal employer.
Yes, sir. That is the way these codes have come up, been drafted, that due to the various threshold level which has been provided, it has provided a big relief to the MSME sector, I should say.
Yes.
Okay. In respect of consent of female workers for night shift and in case of, you know, companies having global operation where they are working on night shifts due to the time variation which is there. So I guess this has to be a part of the HR manual and the appointment letters. So the HR policies need to be overhauled. You'll agree with this, right?
Yes, I do agree. And this aspect is very clear as per section 43 of OSH code, and now women employees can be employed during the night shift with their consent.
Yes, so we'll move on to the next code, I think. Yeah, thanks. So the next code is the Industrial Relation Code, and it is subsuming three acts, which is the Trade Union Act, the Industrial Dispute Act, and the Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act. Yeah. So this code is applicable on the all the industrial establishment, and the industry has been defined as per the judicial pronouncement in the Bangalore water supply case. So it is a systematic activity carried on by cooperation between employer and worker, and for production of supply or distribution of goods, services with a view to satisfy human wants and wishes. So however, it excludes from its applicability the not-for-profit sector. So the enterprises which are working in the social or philanthropic sector, the applicability of this code is not on them. And in case of, like I was discussing with Mr. Dalal in the previous code, this code has also provided various threshold level for various provision, so that you know, the benefit is provided to various industries and the various sectors by the appropriate government by issuing the various guidelines and the threshold levels. So the first concept we will discuss under this code is the concept of fixed term employment. So this is the new provision which has been included in the code, and it has provided a flexibility to the industry. It's a big relief. It's a concept which is, and the relief is there, which is not there in the whole world. Like it provides that you can have employees on fixed term employment. There is no time limit which has been prescribed for how long the employment needs to be there. So it could be something like 6 months, or it could be something like 5 years. The only condition which is provided is that you need to provide them the benefits in terms of the working hours, the working condition, and the retirement benefits, which should be equal to the permanent employees. And the when the contract comes to an end, it won't be considered as a retrenchment. So this is one beneficial provision, and the flexibility which has been provided by the government to the industry. In case of the next act which is coming over here is the Standing Order Act. Again, over here, the threshold level which is provided is the 300 workers. So if you have something below 300, you need not comply with the standing order provisions. And for the standing order also, the central government is the appropriate authority and will come out, and it has already come out with the model standing order for the manufacturing and service industry. And the model standing order also has the provisions of work from home kind of a thing. They are still open in the public domain, so we'll not go into the details of that. However, the provisions are, if you are going to just adopt those model standing order, then the only thing which you are required to do is to provide an intimation, online intimation to the authority. And once you provide the intimation, they will be registered as your model standing order. However, in case there is any change that you'll require in the model standing order and you'll not like to adopt the same as it is, in that case, you need to take approvals. Also, one thing is that the appropriate government has been authorized to exempt any kind of industry or sector it feels that it need to exempt. So this is one authority which has been provided to the appropriate government. In terms of strikes and lockouts, the provisions are very clear, and it is not possible to go on flash strike kind of a situation now, because a notice is mandatory, and notice is for a 14 days, which has a validity of 60 days. And also, in case there is anything pending, like before the conciliation proceedings are going on, or the arbitration proceeding is going on, or it is before the national or the industrial tribunal, then in that case also, you cannot go on strike. That is prohibited. So the provisions are something what we have currently under the public utility system. In terms of the retrenchment, layoff, and closure provisions, retrenchment, I already mentioned that provision is not applicable in case of a fixed term employment. However, again, over here, a lot of flexibility provided to the industry. In case you have anything below 50, there is no applicability. For 50 to 300, you just need to follow the process. No approvals required. However, if it is more than 300, then you need to go for approval. In respect of the mechanism related to your grievances, grievance redressal committee is mandatory. In case you have 20 or more workers employed, the committee's strength cannot be should be more, around 10, and out of that, equal representation from the employer and the employee. And in case your organization has women workers, then a proportionate representation has to be there from them. And in case anything goes to the grievance redressal committee, it has to be resolved within a period of 30 days. So there are time limits given. There is a limitation also provided, like how old a grievance can be. Also, an individual is now authorized to raise an industrial dispute, which was not there currently. So if there is an individual who is the one who is aggrieved party, then he can also go ahead and file a complaint. And apart from grievous redressal committee, there is a provision for working committee. And the works committee, if you have 100 or more workers, then in that case, you have to go for the formation of a works committee. After that, there is a conciliation officer, which is an outsider and it's a government appointed person. Then we have the industrial tribunal and the national tribunal. So that is the way the whole mechanism has been built up. When we come to the Trade Union Act, what has been provided is the compulsory recognition of the trade unions. You need to have a negotiating union or a council. In case you have a trade union where 51% of your workers are a member of the trade union, then you have to give it a recognition as a negotiating union. In case that is not there, then you need to have a council of unions, and the proportion is specified under the code. When we come to, there is new responsibility on the employer in case of retrenchment, that is for providing funds to the reskilling fund. So if you retrench any worker, in that case, you have to deposit 15 days wages with the reskilling fund, and then the government is going to, within a period of 45 days, transfer this fund to the worker who has been retrenched. So this is an additional burden. Mr. Dalal, with respect to applicability of code, so it is very clearly provided that this is not applicable on not-for-profit sector. So this is a relief which has been provided to that sector, right?
Yes, very true. And it is very clear from the definition of industry, specifically 2P subclause 1, and the institutions owned or managed by organization wholly or substantially engaged by any charitable, social or philanthropic, charitable, social or philanthropic services are excluded from the definition of industry.
Okay. So, sir, the next flexibility which has been provided is fixed term employment. Now, we can have a fixed term, though the government has gone ahead and, banned the employment of contract labor in the core activity, but we have this provision of having the fixed term employee in the core activity. So this is a good benefit which everyone can take, everyone can avail of. And this is something which is going to increase the FDI in India, and because of the easy terms of employment which this will provide. So in terms of the fixed term employees, sir, the code talks about the engagement of worker, but what about any person who would be there in the managerial or administrative capacity? Can we have them also on the fixed term employment?
I think to answer this question, if we do a literal interpretation of the code, as per the IR code, section 2O, the term fixed term employee Employment means engagement of a worker. It is clearly provided here that it is engagement of a worker, and worker is expressly defined. So I think in the Industrial Relation Code, the intention of the legislature is to have fixed term for a worker.
Okay, sir, but then the worker's definition, if we look at the various judicial decisions, it has been interpreted in a very liberal way, and sometimes we have very qualified technical people also who have been termed as worker. So I think like this is something which we'll have to look at each and every kind of a person who has been employed and take a decision, right?
Correct, correct. The liberal interpretation of worker will be applicable here also.
Okay, sir. Also, when we talk about the reskilling fund, so everyone has an opinion that the cost of compliances due to all these things have really gone up. So what is the view you can share on the matter?
In the long term, I think this reskilling fund will only upgrade the skill of worker and will lead to better productivity in future. So if we take a longer term horizon, this will only increase productivity and reduce the cost of an employer.
Okay. So in terms of the exemption from the Standing Order Act for IT, ITS companies, which is already there in some states currently, over here under the IR code, the appropriate government has been authorized again to provide the exemptions. So we'll have to wait for the state government's notification and rules to come out to see whether the IT and ITS company should go ahead and do the compliances or wait for those state rules. What is your view?
The Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act, which has been subsumed in the IR code, basically applies on industrial establishments. And if we see the definition of industrial establishment, it does include IT and ITS and also service sector. So these IT and ITS companies will have to comply, and these standing orders will be applicable on them also. And if you see the recent draft notification of standing order available for public comments now, two separate standing orders have been put up in public domain. One is for the manufacturing and other is for service sector. So they are available on the public domain for comments and suggestions.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thanks for your comment. In the interest of time, we'll like to move forward quickly. I'll hand over to my colleague, Akhil.
Thanks, Lina. Going to the next slide. Quickly cover these two slides, which is important as everyone is eagerly waiting for the code to become effective. Clearly, there is more to come, especially the rules under the four codes needs to be notified. This would also include the schemes for various category of workers under the Social Security Code, formats for returns, registers, etc. Various state governments also need to frame their rules by March 21 for areas where the state governments have been given a jurisdiction. Appointment of appellate authorities, tribunals, other bodies under the court. So there's more to come, and employers are required to be cognizant of these new developments and evaluate the effect of on their organizations. And moving to the next slide, we've highlighted before we conclude to this today's session and hand it over to Mr. Rao to conclude and share his views. I would like to highlight the key areas for consideration, both from employees and contract labor perspective for each and every employer. From employees' perspective, it's review of the payroll policies, from monthly disbursement change, as we've seen the change in the time limit for full and final settlement. So everything needs to be looked into, and detailed review of the complete HR function, including from compensation structure to factor in changes in definition of wages. Terms of employment and engagement, like fixed term employees, as we talked about it, working hours, overtime, etc. And each and everything has an impact on the P&L. So everything needs to be looked into an adoption on adherence to the occupational safety and health standards. And from a contract labor perspective, as we've seen, there's changes in each and every code. So obligation on establishment to pay contractor before wages payment due dates, also obligation towards bonus, gratuity, other benefits due to contract employees where contractor defaults. So we have a far-reaching implication. So I'll hand over to Mr. Rao to, you know, and again, thanks everyone for participating, and thanks ISCC for giving us this opportunity to collaborate and, you know, share this wonderful, you know, our view on this labor code. Thanks, and over to you, Mr. Rao.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your great session. And it is not easy to cover the labor laws or the tax laws, etc., in a session of 1 hour or 1.5 hour. And also, we should thank the government for taking up the long pending issues or long pending laws into consideration. Say, for example, GST Act, One Nation, One Act kind of thing. And then recently, they attempted the education system, what you call revamping the thing. And now the bringing 29 labor laws into one four codes of labor laws is again a Herculean task. And I should thank Grant Thornton for organizing this session in such a simple and then very meticulous way. Initially, they described about the codes, individual codes, and then when each code they raised the points to ponder, and then the clarifications from Dalal Saab simultaneously for each code. I mean, the session, which is a vast thing with, to be covered in 1.5 hour, is this thing. But however, I think after the implementation of these codes, labor laws, I think we need maybe 1 day session to our all our participants, all our associate members, etc., so that we can take benefit out of it. So at the same time, I, on behalf of Indo-American Chamber of Commerce, would like to thank to our esteemed speakers of this session, Mr. Ankul Dalal, Regional Labor Commissioner, Ministry of Labor and Employment. He has taken a lot of time out from his busy schedule and then patiently responding to so many questions from the panelists as well as from the other participants. And also the Mr. Akhil Chanda, Associate Partner, Grant Thornton, Bharat, and also Ms. Leena Madhuk, Director, Grant Thornton, Bharat, for joining us today and sharing their knowledgeable with our members. I would like to thank Grant Thornton for our acknowledgement partner for the support and association. Special thanks to our member, Mr. Sanjay Jain, for connecting with the team. I also like to thank and congratulate our chairman, APTS branch, Mr. Vijay Sai Garu, for initiating such informative and then useful webinars for members. And then we hope that we keep doing such kind of webinars so that it will be very useful to the associate members. Last but not least, I thank all our participants for attending this informative session. And I'm sure that each one of you will be benefited by interesting deliberations of this session. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, all the participants. Thank you, panelists. And I think we have seen it's more than 500 across the participants. We once again thank you from the association. Thank you.